Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Welcome to Pro-Life Berks. We are very pleased that we have, again, this is a Monday night instead of a Tuesday, and we're on for a full hour instead of a half an hour. So we hope that you really enjoy our program. Tonight we have representatives from St. Francis Home, and my co-host tonight also is Kathy Kuhns.
And so, I just want to say, when I was introducing last month, I forgot to mention Carolyn as my co-host, so I went to publicly apologize.
Oh my goodness, that's not necessary at all.
Just thought I'd do that. But good evening.
Yes, and I wanted the girls to, and the ladies to introduce themselves because they have a lot to tell us. So would you want to start, Mary Ellen?
Sure. Hi, my name is Mary Ellen Mareland, and I'm on the board at St. Francis Home, and I also am in charge of their business development and creating social awareness in the community.
Good evening. My name is Kathy Goss. I'm a board of directors. I'm the secretary at the present time. Before we begin, I'd like to thank BCTV for this opportunity to get to, out to the public who St. Francis Home is. We're very excited about this project, and we have a lot to share with you tonight.
Kathy, could you tell us a little bit just what is St. Francis
Home?
Sure.
I'm going to start in the beginning. It's probably about 10 years now. We had two hospice nurses in the Reading area that were taking care of a terminally ill patient. And they would come and go into this family's home, and they were blessed. They had a daughter, and they had a family support, and they had neighbors who also supported their care. The nurses, however, started to tell a story that was a little different of all their other patients that didn't have that support. And they were very frustrated because many times, especially in the Berks area, we had a husband and a wife, and one of them would become terminally ill, and the care would then fall onto the other spouse. Also, let's be honest, the family dynamics isn't the same. In the days long ago, as my father would say to me, we had families that stayed in the same town that they grew up and born in. And today, because of the economy, many families have to be separated, and the family support isn't there. Of course, we always have the military where individuals have to travel, and they're not at home with their loved ones as well. So the story goes like this. We need to have a place where individuals can go, not just to take care of the patient that was handled by the hospice provider, but also their families. Many of the families become very burnt out by taking care of their loved ones. So St. Francis was a dream of these two hospice nurses. But their dream did not fall on deaf ear, for the daughter heard their story, and she had many connections, and she decided to put some action into play. So we started looking, started looking for some good people to support her in her journey, to help these hospice nurses have their dream come to a reality. And with that, she knew of several homes in the Syracuse area in New York, and we went and talked to them, and we found out what they did and how they started, and we had a lot of learnings from that, from those initial conversations. We then came back, and we started this dream a little further. We brought in additional people to be on the board, and the board started to say, What are our next steps? Do we find a house? Do we refurbish the house to be the house that we can have our residents stay in, that have the wide hallways, that have the wide doors that will accommodate the beds and the equipment that that resident may need? So what happened was we were looking in the form of finding a home that we can refurbish. But right then, somebody came and tapped us on the shoulder and said, I heard about this dream, and I would like to donate land. So our conversation went from refurbishing to building. I'd like to show you for the first slide. As the volunteers started putting their heads together, they came up with this drawing of what we envision our home to look like. It would be a ranch home. There would be no steps. It would be that designed in such a way that the individuals can come in and out without having to, you know, having to climb steps. And obviously the wheelchair accessible is now present in our home. So we started our journey. We had our dream. We had the house. So we started looking at how are we going to build this home. So we started having development meetings, and we started raising some money. We then found a contractor who was willing to help us out. And I'd like to show you the beginning of our dream. So our dream actually started with a lot.
That's pretty.
And you can see it's well overgrown, large trees. So obviously the first thing that we had to do is to clear the way. So we did get an excavator in. He obviously went through. He tried to save as many trees as we can because we wanted that appearance. It's very peaceful and quiet. It's also home of a lot of the deer, some red foxes, a turtle, by the way, that crosses our street every day.
And the birds.
And the birds. Oh, the birds are beautiful. So again, we knew what we had to do. You can see the growth of these trees were rather large. We started moving the dirt. We were excited. We were really excited. It was becoming a reality.
Now, when was this? What year?
2016. We started, actually.
In the spring?
Actually, it was in the summer, late summertime, because what happened, and you're going to see.
Oh, no.
Mother Nature decided to put a little halt to our build. She was not so kind to us several times during this build, and we'll go into that a little later. But she did give us the beautiful views that we have at our home today. We then started to put our foundation in. It was definitely coming around. You can see all the heavy equipment that was brought in and the amount of dirt that was removed.
Wow. Was this one contractor or did you have volunteer
workers? We were blessed.
Workers
we had,
as well?
We had, Berks Homes was very good to us and they actually built our home. But we did have a lot of things that were donated to us that made the build that much easier for us.
Very nice.
I'm sorry, there's some more slides coming up. I apologize.
So you had the seed idea. Where did the seed money come from?
Again, we had some very generous people who believed in the mission, and they helped us get initially started.
Oh, wonderful.
That's one thing I can tell you. The Berks area, the businesses, they came to us, they met with us, and they obviously exceeded any expectations that we could have had.
Right.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah. Wonderful.
Back to some of the photos. For those who have built a home, you can understand our excitement when we started seeing the first footers going in.
It's beautiful land.
And it's in such a beautiful area because it's, I guess you would call it a cul-de-sac. When you look, the whole backside of the house actually faces the whole wooded area. And it sits up a little higher.
Whereabouts in Shillington is this? Is this up?
If you're coming in South Wymason, like, South Wymason Boulevard and turn on Penwyn, where there's a little playground that sits on the corner, and you go up, you will fund into...
near St. John de La Salle Church? Is it?
You're close to it, but not in the
town. But higher?
And then you would go to Orchard, and then from Orchard to Hillside, where we're located.
Okay.
So when you... Oh, I'm sorry. When you drive it down to the driveway, you actually look like you're going into nowhere.
Really?
Because it's just so beautiful and quiet. Yeah. And we've managed to maintain a lot of the trees there. The whole one side overlooks the trees.
Oh, that's...
And like Kathy had said earlier, there's lots of deer and their babies. And they come right up alongside the house.
And eat our flowers at times. So if I can go back to the slides.
Sure.
The construction then continued, and if I neglected to say, this land that we were given came to us from an individual, and the land was donated in her husband's memory of Dr. Robert M. Pink. And I'll talk a little bit further about that.
And that was Peggy that gave the land,
correct?
Right? Peggy's a saint. She's a very generous person.
So with some of our fundraising, we actually had people who donated the windows. And the prices range in the size of the window. So each window has a name to it attached through the donation of that individual.
Oh, that's nice. Like a church almost. Where are the names?
We are still
putting those on. Oh, you're putting those on. Okay. Yeah. Oh, that's
so
nice.
Again, a lot of excitement at this time when you actually start to see the walls go up and the individual rooms starting to be developed. Our basement is huge. We've made jokes about it that we would like to put a bowling alley down there, but right now, if you had an opportunity to visit St. Francis Home, you would see shelves in the basement Local schools did penny march and walks, and they supplied us with paper products that probably will last us 2 years.
Wow.
Oh, that's
very
nice.
Generous to the children. This is actually the back of the home as you come in. We literally converted our homes from the front to the back because the residence rooms on the back have beautiful bay windows, and they could sit on the bay windows and watch the sights outside their windows.
Lovely.
So we did it by design.
So it turned out best that you didn't have to refurbish something. This was...
This was absolutely as God sent to us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So obviously the home was built. Now, we had to furnish the inside of the home. So we went out again. We went out to the business community. And again, far exceeded any expectations that we could have ever imagined.
That's beautiful.
Oh, it's pretty.
This is our home today. As you can see, we did put the handicap railing up in the front door. In May of this year, actually, the Chamber of Commerce recognized us and had a ribbon cutting service for us, which was an exciting time for us at the St. Francis home. Now, St. Francis home is a single family home. It is not a medical facility. It's a social model. And I want to go and let everybody understand what the difference is. When our residents come to our home, usually it's because they don't have the family support, as I talked about earlier. And what they will do is they come to us with a hospice provider already under contract with them. So we are no different if I had my mother in my home and I was taking care of my mother with my friends and my family. We become the extended family of that resident and they become ours. And we treat each other just like family. Their family and friends can come and go and see their loved one at any time. Our doors are open 24/7. We do ask, though, however, if they come after 8 o'clock at night, that they notify us that we have the doors, you know, that we can meet them at the front door. We highly encourage the participation of loved ones and friends and family to stay with, stay in the room with the resident and talk to them and to spend the day with them or spend hours with them. But if they can't, our volunteers will do that. Our volunteers range in anything from gardening, shoveling snow, doing grass cutting. We have a personal, I call him my personal chef for St. Francis.
Wow.
He's unbelievable. He'll make a lot of different foods for us based on the needs of that resident and what they can tolerate or what they would like to have. And then, of course, we have hands-on care. And our volunteers will be in that room 24/7 if necessary, by the side of that resident. It is our mission that nobody will die alone. Our mission statement, I'd like to take 2 seconds just to read it, and I will read it because I don't have it memorized and I don't want to be in error. St. Francis Home is dedicated to providing comfort and compassionate care with dignity to people with terminal illness in a loving, faith-based family environment, regardless of the ability to pay. And that's how we run our operation. Each of our volunteers are trained, and they know that the needs of our residents, because they do change from resident to resident, and they will help us take care of that resident until the end of life.
So if someone doesn't have a family, and maybe they don't have any medical coverage, they could still be accepted and all their expenses covered?
We do not charge for any services that St. Francis does. If they come to us with hospice, the monies are given to the hospice provider. And actually, Mary Ellen will go a little bit more into that.
Okay. And is there an age, are there any restrictions, age or otherwise?
The mission of St. Francis is to take on anybody. We are cautious, however, about children. There are specific things that we have to monitor with children, but we will look at every potential resident as a resident to our home at this point. Right now, our residents have been senior citizens. And again, we're not only helping the resident themselves, but the family. I can only tell you that several times in meeting the caregiver and the amount of lack of sleep that they have been deprived of, as well as their own health. Within days of coming to our home, you can see that the primary caregiver starts to rebound. And it gives them time to basically have some time to themselves. because it's a whole concept of taking care of the resident as well as the family. Mm-hmm.
Well, this is a whole different concept that we're used to having hospice in a hospital, maybe in even in the prison, in someone's home. So this is a whole different concept.
It's a social model.
And
it's
you said this is the model. Only one in Pennsylvania.
This is the only one That's that I wonderful. Know of. I know there was another organization out in the Midwest Pennsylvania that was starting up. I don't know where they stand on it. Many homes in the New York, I heard of Jersey, as well as Delaware. Our last resident had family in Florida, and they told us very openly that this is common in Florida as well.
Oh, is that right?
So this, again, is a social model. We're not a medical facility. We just follow the orders of what the hospice prescribes for that resident.
If any of our audience have any questions, we please do encourage you to call in. Our number is 610-378-0426. We'll put it up on the screen for
and
you
as well.
We
have very knowledgeable guests this evening. They're just delightful.
So please feel free to
Are the residents mainly from Berks County, or do you get them from other areas?
We get inquiries from other areas, but our residents to date have been Berks County.
Berks County. Oh, that's nice.
Yes.
That's very nice.
But again, we will take calls from other individuals outside of the Berks County area.
Do you provide transportation if someone has to go to the doctor or for a
Again, if they
treatment?
Come to us, they are assigned a nurse and a doctor with that hospice provider. And if necessary, we'll make a place to call to the hospice provider, and they will send the nurse over to evaluate the situation.
Okay.
We do have individuals that do driving for us that go grocery mm-hmm. shopping. So there are a lot of other things. We had a resident who had one night, she just said, I could really go for a good cheeseburger. And one of our residents was out the door and back before I knew it. And she went down to the local restaurant and got a big, thick cheeseburger. And our resident enjoyed every morsel that she could eat.
And a lot of times there's so much family support there that the family is also willing to run out and get whatever their loved one wants or what they want.
Yeah.
A lot of times... when they're visiting their loved one, they will go out and get Chinese food or pizza or whatever type of food that they would like, and they bring it into the home and have their
and
meal there.
And those are probably the things they would want to be doing rather than being worn out from 24/7, care. So it's nice they can show those little acts of love. That's wonderful.
And it's nice because it's in a home.
Yes,
it's in
I love
a beautiful
that.
Home environment as opposed
And you said there's, did you say the rooms? There's three bedrooms, right?
We're three bedrooms, and each bedroom has its own private bath. They
That's
have roll-in
nice.
Showers if necessary to allow that individual that they could sit and be bathed by the
hospice
provider.
In their wheelchair.
It's a chair. It's not
and then
a chair.
It's a
large shower chair.
Okay.
Or seated bench.
I should take just a few minutes to show you the inside of the home, because as beautiful as our inside is just as nice.
Mm.
In front of you, you see a tree that was painted by a local artist. It's going to contain all the names of all our contributors that have been very generous to us throughout the years. This is a boardroom, I also call it a dining hall. If the family wants to come in and have a private dinner with their loved ones, they can close the doors. There's French doors and have privacy and have their own
That's nice.
Their own dinner. This is our kitchen and our kitchen table. And again,
Beautiful.
Everything that you are seeing here has been donated by local businesses. Mm.
This is incredible.
It is. It's really pretty.
And you're the only one in Pennsylvania.
The chapel.
Yes. The chapel is in memory of Dr. Robert Impink.
Uh-huh.
It's housed right now. I believe we have 12 chairs in there. A story that I think is amazing, a gentleman had a tree, an oak tree, that fell down on his property, and he took it and he constructed the altar and the two pieces that you see there. 600 hours of love went into that altar and into the two side pieces. The cross you see in front of you, unfortunately the light from the camera, was a donation from Francis House in Syracuse. When they realized what we were doing, and they were very supportive of us, they gave a little bit of them to us so we can keep them always close.
Beautiful windows. Boy, what a view.
Absolutely. We had some conversations if we were going to put anything up at the windows, but we all agreed that this is the beautiful sunlight and the moonlight at night.
Yeah, and snow.
And snow.
Oh,
all
my
the seasons.
Goodness.
This is an example of one of our residents' room. Again, when the resident comes to us, the hospice providers will bring all the equipment that they need, and the bed will be basically to the needs of that individual resident. The chairs are lift chairs, so that if we take our resident from the bed and put him into the chair to watch TV or sit and listen to music or just sit quietly or read, that the lift chair will help us get that individual resident from the chair back to the bed. This is our gathering area, as family room.
That's pretty.
Okay. I just wanted to show you the love that we have received from the community. And it's both businesses and individuals that have come to help with little things and to make St. Francis home a home. And that's exactly what we are. We are an extension of the family. We are there now. We're their home. And we want to make them as comfortable as possible.
Well, this is for end of life.
Correct.
What is the average stay for a person before they have to go home?
The average stay that we have
to heaven
is about 28 days. Mm-hmm. The individual. Now, obviously, some will stay longer, and some may go sooner than we anticipate. But again, it's God's will.
But have no limitation on how long a person can stay.
They're on hospice. Hospice has their own guidelines of
they do.
Before they put an individual on hospice.
So they pretty much know what Correct. The length is remaining.
Yeah, hospice rules are 60 days. I believe it's 60 days, or 6 months.
Six months.
And if anything happens that the person recovers or seems to recover,
they
can be removed from hospice because hospice does not allow for care of the disease or whatever it is that they're terminal from. But if they become like pneumonia or something like this, they can be treated for that.
Correct.
But if they happen to recover, then they can come out of hospice go back home.
Yeah, that is correct.
That's nice.
And a lot of times when people are in a setting like this and they're getting quality care, mm-hmm. and they improve.
I would imagine they do, because they're getting better nourishment and liquids. And
yes. So like you were saying, somebody can come off of hospice, mm-hmm. and if the need arises, they can go back onto hospice.
Uh-huh.
If somebody lives past the 6 months that they were initially diagnosed with to become mm-hmm. eligible for hospice, the physician could sign paperwork and say mm-hmm. yes, that they still need the hospice service.
Yeah. So they can get an extension.
They can get it for longer than 6 months.
Because sure there are times when you can't tell.
Because with hospice, to be certified and eligible for hospice, a physician must state that according to a normal disease process, that person would have 6 months or less to live.
Mm-hmm.
However, if they live past that 6 months, the doctor can certify that they still are eligible for hospice under Medicare guidelines.
Now, the home itself, are you inspected by any government agencies, or is this treated as a home?
This is treated as a home. The only inspection that we did go through was for insurance purposes.
Okay.
Okay, but that's no different than if you went to insurance.
Nice. That's really nice. The less strings attached, the better.
So would you like to talk a little bit about the hospice providers?
Sure. Okay. first of all, I'm just going to talk about how hospice actually came about. So according to an internet search, the name was first applied to specialized care for dying patients by a physician named Dr. Saunders. And she began her work with the terminally ill in 1948 and eventually went on to create the first modern hospice, which was St. Christopher's Hospice, and that was in the residential suburbs of London. Mm. The first U.S. hospice, which was the Connecticut Hospice, served patients starting in 1974. So hospice is a pretty new concept.
Mm-hmm.
And throughout the 80s, hospice programs were established in many U.S. cities. And then according to the National Hospice and Palliative Care Organization report in 2016, the first hospital-based palliative care consult service was established at the Wayne State University School of Medicine.
Oh, can you just stop right there? We have a home viewer. How delightful. Welcome. What is your question?
Hey, ladies, how are you doing this evening?
Fine, how are you? Do you have a question for us?
Yep, two questions for you.
Okay.
As a resident of Berks County, what do you think the main request that St. Francis Home would have as a community? What would you request from the community to help you guys?
Well, we are basing our numbers off of the other homes in the area that we've had dialogue, but we can envision anywhere from 39 to 44 families that we'd be able to serve in a year. Did that answer your question?
It does. So you're saying you need some help with volunteers and so forth?
Oh, we're always looking for volunteers. actually, I'll have our number come up on the screen a little later. Always looking for volunteers. Right now, we're asking our volunteers to do 4 hours at a time. And again, our volunteers, their needs vary. We are going with one bed right now in order to get all our volunteers comfortable with the care of that individual resident. But it's our hope that within a reasonable time frame, all three beds will be filled.
And how else could people, other items they could donate? I think that's what he was trying to get at. What do
are you
need?
Asking donations?
What could the community do to help
well,
you
first
out?
Of all, prayers. We always ask for prayers first because it is by the grace of God that we are able to do what we have done. Number two, we are looking for volunteers. And volunteers can range from, you know, I was laughing earlier, we have individuals that just love to cut the grass and to play in our gardens. And they play in our gardens quite a bit because the deer also play in our gardens. And we're always putting new flowers down. Of course, snow removal is an issue for us. We have to make sure that our roads are clear, that if we have to bring a resident in or a resident leaving our home, that we have the roads clear. Like I said, some people like to do shopping, so they'll take our grocery list and go grocery shopping for us. One gentleman loves to cook, and he's an excellent chef, and he makes the most delicious soups that we've ever had in the world.
Mary Ellen is
nodding my head, yes.
How nice is that?
Absolutely. Yes. We have individuals who love to clean, and they show up, and they clean our home.
I don't think I'll help you clean, though. So, next question I have.
But before you go on, to your next question, I was just going to say that there's also volunteers that actually work and play with the actual resident that's there.
There's interaction, correct. They're hands-on.
They can read to them. They can play games with them, cards with them, talk sports. Whatever seems to be the interest of that person or the person who's volunteering, they can bring things in just to make them happy. Somebody brought in their
and
cell phone.
And companionship, just
so they could have
FaceTime
on a telephone or a
FaceTime with their family that's not local.
Yes, if you have a cell phone. So there's lots of opportunities to give comfort to the person that's there. So what is
and
your
second? And just be yourself. You don't have to have any special expertise, but just a willingness to be a friend.
That's absolutely right? Correct.
And you had a second question?
I do. Do you guys have any fundraisers throughout the year to help raise funds for your organization?
We absolutely do. We have a major fundraiser every year. It's a silent auction and a dinner. We obviously have campaigns throughout the year that we send out information to the... We have about almost a 700 address base that we use to do our fundraising on. We also go with grants and then personal information that people find out about us and believe in our cause are very generous in donating to us.
Do you have an email list?
Yes, we do have an email list.
Someone can give them their email.
Yeah, Kathy's going to give that information at the end of the program for you to contact them. So just keep watching.
I will.
Thank you for calling.
Sounds like an excellent idea.
Yeah.
We'll raise a lot of money for you.
Thank you. Thanks for calling.
We appreciate it, and we look to having you as a volunteer.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
There you go.
Hey,
you
if he wants to help me with fundraising, get him on board.
Yeah. yes. So where were we? Let's
see. We were talking about how hospice got started.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So eventually, government officials began to look at hospice. And they decided that it was actually a humane care for the terminally ill. So once that was established in 1982, Congress initiated the creation of the Medicare hospice benefit, and that became permanent in 1986. Then in 1993, President Clinton installed hospice as a guaranteed benefit and an accepted component of health care provisions. So that's how hospice came about and its background. Also, I would like to share with everybody what hospice care really is. So hospice is a program of care and support for people who are terminally ill with a life expectancy of 6 months or less with a normal disease process. Mm-hmm. Hospice helps not only the resident or the patient, but it also involves their families as well. Hospice helps people who are terminally ill live comfortably. Hospice is not only for people with cancer. You could have other illnesses and diseases and be eligible for hospice. A lot of times when we think of hospice, I think most of us think of a patient with cancer, mm-hmm. but that doesn't have to be the case.
And no age requirement of any kind?
Correct.
So a child could be put into hospice?
Absolutely. Okay. Yes. The focus for hospice is actually comfort care. And it's not the person at this point when they are in hospice, they're not looking to get curative care. Mm-hmm. Okay, they want to focus on comfort as well as quality of life. There's a special team of hospice. There's a whole hospice team. And that team is a bunch of professionals and caregivers that provide care for the whole person, including their physical, emotional, social, and spiritual needs. And the services can include physical care, counseling, social worker, medications, all of their equipment, and any types of supplies that that person will need during their care.
And who does the referral? Is it their general physician or do the social services? Who makes the decision to even ask for the services?
Well, there can be a lot of people with that input. So depending on where somebody is at the time of the diagnosis, that would really play into who their part of the team is. Okay. So as an example, if they're home with their family, when they go to the physician and the physician has the conversation with them that, you know, you might want to consider hospice, mm-hmm. at that point, then the doctor would have to certify they were eligible.
Okay.
And then the family could talk to a social worker, mm-hmm. You know, if they're at a cancer center, and they could help make that referral to a hospice provider. If somebody were in a skilled nursing facility and they were going to mm-hmm. stay in a skilled nursing facility, then the social worker would help them, mm-hmm. you know, with a hospice provider. So, a lot of different options.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay.
Yep.
So again, when our residents call us or their family members call us, they have already chosen their hospice provider. That is not one of the services that St. Francis offers. We want to make sure that they choose the hospice provider of their choice. Have some additional questions?
I think you mentioned a little bit about insurance. If they have insurance, does that cover most of their costs, or how does that work?
Yes. Under Medicare, hospice is covered at 100%.
Oh, it is?
Only Medicare. For 100 days.
Hospice is cared for 100%
for the 6 months?
Yes. As long as the person meets the Medicare or insurance guidelines,
right.
then insurance will continue to pay for the services.
Okay.
If somebody does not have Medicare and they have a commercial insurance, mm-hmm. it is a covered service as well.
And what's the average length that most insurance companies cover? Do they also cover the 6 months?
That I wouldn't know. It would be based on each individual policy.
Okay. So there's no set agreement, so to speak, on if the hospice is good for 6 months, then you would think the insurance companies would offer to pay for the 6 months, maybe not.
In terms of the commercial insurances, I honestly do not know that answer. So I wouldn't want to misspeak.
Well, the hospice is covered by the insurance, and it's actually a win-win for the people that are receiving the care as well as the insurance company and for the families, because what that does is it's saying they know they're terminally ill. Mm-hmm. So as Mary Ellen said, their care is to give them comfort and to relieve their pain and to relieve their suffering. They're not running to the emergency room. Mm-hmm. They're not, you know, getting all kinds of medications for all different types of things with the hopes that sometimes something's going to happen to save them. They have realize that this is mostly like with the cancer, they know it's terminal. Mm-hmm. So it saves the emergency rooms, it saves the doctor's visits, it saves all those things. But yet, like I say,
it saves money, but at the same time it provides better care than what they had previously.
And if they do have something like a cold or a virus or something, of course that gets treated.
That's correct.
I mentioned at dinner that my father died in 1978, and there was a hospice nurse. He was at home, and that must have been the very early, this was in Allentown, so this must have been the very early stages of hospice care. But all they did was come and give a home visit to assess pain and what kind of pain medication needed.
And then they left.
Yeah, I mean, it was an hour, right. And she came maybe every 3-4 days. And then there was a home health worker that would come and help with the bathing. But the pain was the hard thing to really control. That's, you know, someone's end stage cancer. That's really difficult.
And now hospice has evolved so much that now some hospice agencies actually provide music therapy.
Oh, really?
They will have people come in with their instruments and play music. They also have pet therapy.
I was going to ask about that.
Yes, and there
this home needs a dog. You need to get a...
Well, don't you take your dog?
I did. I did an overnight shift, and I did bring my dog with me one night.
That's really neat. That's what I would want.
Yes.
And the residents are also encouraged, if they have a pet that their loved one knows, to bring it along. We are very cautious, though, about cats because of allergies of individuals. Yeah. And dog bites, so we ask the necessary questions before they bring the animal into the home. But no, we agree that there are other things that can bring a meaningful life. We want our residents to know that their life meant something
with
while they were there.
Oh, absolutely. Dignity. And
the dignity. And
right.
We are there with them through the last breath. We're there for the families. I can't tell you that the relationships that we have made with the families is I can't even begin to have the right words. Because one of the residents, I kept saying, our home is your home. Your home is our home. Our family is your family. And when we went to the funeral, I made a comment. He said, are you coming to the dinner afterwards? And I made a comment, no, enjoy it with your family. He said, excuse me, you are my family. And so he used my words. And I realized that sometimes you have to be very cautious. But we truly believe that we are an extended family of them and them of us.
Now, how did the two of you get involved? You're not nurses, or were you in healthcare at all? Or how did you get involved?
Well, I can tell you that Nancy, who was the daughter of the patient that I made reference to in the beginning, she knew that I walked the walk. I had loved ones that I took care of. So she knew that I would have an understanding of what this concept was and have an understanding that there is a need here in the Berks County area. So she brought me on right from the beginning, and we've been there together and gotten to this point.
How about you, Mary Ellen?
Well, Nancy has another friend.
She's busy.
Who contacted me. Nancy's other friend contacted me.
Uh-huh.
And knowing some of the background and some of the things that I've done in throughout my career, explained St. Francis Home to me and told me about the opportunities that were available. Mm-hmm. So then I decided to join the board.
And she brings a whole level of excitement. And also has a lot
of... Oh, tell us, some examples.
She has, you know, she says, well, have we ever thought of this type of fundraiser? So she thinks outside the box that we haven't thought about. So we're evaluating.
That's wonderful.
But she is she's here to bring ideas to the table, and we're looking forward to seeing if some of them actually come to reality and work out for us.
You know, hospice, my father was in hospice, but it was way back when it first started, as you were given the history there. It was one of the very beginnings. And my mother and I didn't understand at least maybe she did, but she didn't tell me, that that was end of the life care. Mm-hmm. And so my mom said, you know, dad's pretty sick, and I was married already with children, and she said, do you think he could come over for a few days? Not really realizing that, yeah, I mean, he's like really sick. Mm-hmm. And he's doing fine. I mean, he's all perky and everything. And this man would come and visit him and take him for a ride and help him. He had all these tools, and he helped him sort them out and, you know, do these type of things. And was making my father very happy about it. And then he said to us, he says, I think you better invite the family. He said, it would be a good time for them to kind of say goodbye. And I'm like, really? So it was like end of October near Halloween time, and my sister was like, how do we have a party when dad's so sick? And we made it into a Halloween party. Invited everybody, said, we're going to have a Halloween party. Nice. That's what we told them. Mm-hmm. And it was wonderful. And it was only 3 days later when he
really?
Did pass.
Wow.
And again, the hospice care person was there and said, I think you better call the priest. And again, we were like, no,
yeah,
no. And everything was like, it was comforting. Mm-hmm. And it was in our own home. But people that are in your place will probably have that kind of experience too, rather than being in the hospital.
Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of times where the family members will say, we just don't have the room for the hospital equipment. Mm-hmm. So without becoming a hazard to somebody else's tripping in the home. So the rooms are big, and they accommodate the equipment. And
including oxygen sometimes could be a danger.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So you're absolutely correct. So we are, you know, we have all that. Whatever hospice says the needs of that resident are, they bring it with them.
That and is amazing.
We have the training with our volunteers on how to use the equipment. And obviously, you know, we share stories. I'm sorry.
Mm. I was going to say, how long on the average is the training for volunteers?
It depends
on what we're
training.
If someone was interested.
We usually have about a two-hour training. We do criminal background checks on all our volunteers.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. Just to make sure that...
I was going to ask that, yeah.
Yeah, sure. But again, if it's a piece of equipment that we're not familiar with or haven't had in our home with them, we will have additional training for them. But one of the things that we do find interesting is that if I was on, for simplicity of this conversation, say from 7 in the morning to 11, and our resident said something funny or shared something with me about their life, we actually keep a journal so the person who comes in after us can start the conversation where we left off and keep the conversation going.
That's nice.
Or they say, oh, I haven't talked to my grandson in a while. You know, we'll reach out to the family and say, can we have the number for the grandson? And maybe we'll place a call one evening when they feel up to it and talk to their grandson. And, of course, if they have face-to-face with the telephones today, we can use that as well.
Uh-huh.
So it allows us just to keep that individual's life
continuity
meant something
too.
And that we can repeat it and share the stories, you know, further on.
How about you said a little bit about food? How do the meals work? Is there
Whenever
a cook
hungry.
There for each? I mean, do they cook individually for
yes.
each person?
Yes, we do.
That's amazing. Wow.
So, I mean, it could be, and towards the end of life, their appetite is not always that
yeah,
strong.
Yeah, I would think.
So soups have been a staple in our home. Cottage cheese, fruit.
Mm-hmm.
The farmers markets have been very generous to us in terms of giving us pastries and breads at the end of their time.
Oh, that's nice. Wow.
And most of our residents have enjoyed a piece of apple pie once in a while.
How about a glass of wine?
No. I haven't had one ask that. But
I think Mary Ellen's
always the first time.
You're right.
She asked for wine in here.
So, but
my mom's watching.
So what is the hardest thing for you? Mm-hmm. That's always, I'm sure there's so much joy, but what's the toughest thing?
Saying goodbye.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Saying goodbye. The bonds that you make with the residents, I'm going to start crying. It's unbelievable. You don't realize what you have to, you don't realize that you can make a relationship with a complete stranger when you put everything and believe in what you're doing, that you're helping them, mm-hmm. and you see the look in the individual's eyes and the family's eyes, yeah. it makes it all worthwhile. Yeah. But it is very hard to say goodbye.
It's like losing a family member because we become their family,
yeah.
they become ours. And
not only when the resident passes, it's like losing a family member, but also the other family that's with that resident. Mm-hmm. And we've, you know, I haven't been on the board that long, but since I've been there, mm-hmm. I've seen people hugging each other and holding hands and crying and
praying. Sounds like a very loving place.
You know, having people come in the front door, oh, hey, how are you? And, you know, them talking about their kids and what's going on.
Our last residence husband said to me, you know, one of the things he truly appreciated at St. Francis is our volunteers always came in and let his wife know that they were there and when they were leaving and when they were coming back. And he said, you know, he would turn his back and within a couple hours that same volunteer was back in the house. And he says, I thought you weren't coming back to Tuesday next week. And she said, oh, I was at the farmer's market. And she said she likes grapes and I picked some up. So our volunteers think of them outside of their work time and they come and go. Sometimes it's just to say, hi, I was passing the house and I just wanted to see, make sure you were okay. He said he really thought that was unbelievable that our volunteers took time outside their normal schedule to come back and witness and say hi to the resident. He also went on to say that one individual volunteer made a personal phone call to his son who was out of state and talked to him for a length of time and shared stories that she had with her death of her parents and opened him up. And it meant the world to him that somebody reached out to his son outside the home itself and talked to him. So we have some fantastic volunteers. We look forward to having others join us. I do have the information now on screen if we can put it up.
Yeah, if you want to put that up, where people can contact the St. Francis Home.
We're located in.
And if you have any questions at all or you consider volunteering, in a way, it's so simple. It's such a simple act of love to help someone. And yet, you know, you have to make that first step. And sometimes that's the hardest. So I'm sure just calling and whatever wasn't discussed this evening, you can continue the conversation and see if there's something there that you would like to do. And I'm sure they would love to have you.
Absolutely. We do have a web address.
Delightful.
I apologize, it's not up here. It's stfrancishomereading.org. And you can contact us through that website as well. So we look forward to having any type of questions you have. Our doors are always open if you would like to come see us.
Oh, that was the other question. Can people just come stop by or do you need an appointment for a tour if they want to come for a tour?
We give tours, but obviously we are very cautious of the privacy of our residents.
Yeah.
So we ask for a phone call first before stopping in, and we'll be more than happy to show you the home. Obviously, we're looking for volunteers. And hope that we can see some.
And the volunteers don't have to do the nursing care. They have hospice care. They have nurses that come in and you know, bathe them and give them their medications and that type of thing. The hospice people there, the volunteers are there for their comfort.
That's absolutely correct.
And for their emotional support and support for their families as well. So, you know, they don't have to be a nurse. They don't have to have any kind of license or anything of that sort.
Absolutely correct.
So there's no fear that, you know, I'm going to get into
something.
They're
not good enough.
or I have to go give somebody a bath. That's not what it's all about.
And certain, you know, volunteers have a different comfort level and want to do additional, you know, hands-on care. Mm-hmm. But if somebody is not comfortable doing that, that is not a requirement to be a volunteer.
Yeah. We have envelopes to stuff for mailers.
Simple.
So, absolutely. So we look forward to having volunteers, and if you're interested, please call us.
I had a friend who was worked in the state hospital. She was a hairdresser.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, she would be glad to come in and
we have a massage therapist who comes in and rubs backs.
Yeah, there you go.
And, you know, because laying in bed for a period of time, you know, doesn't feel real good, and she'll bring the oils in and rub our residents' backs and then teaches us how to do it so we can continue. So, yes, there's so many things that they can do to serve.
Well, we certainly appreciate having you come and speak with us. This was, like I said, we've done very little on the end of life. We're pro-life, of course, but we're normally talking about abortion. And but we've not done very little on end-of-life issues and euthanasia, which we're going to have another program on assisted suicide because that is... becoming a bigger and bigger problem. But we certainly appreciate your coming
Thank
here
you.
Tonight
appreciate
and sharing
you
your beautiful
us.
Home. Oh my goodness, it just sounds so lovely. And I'd like to go see it. I'm going to, one of these days, I'm going to have to call and maybe Carol and I can go over.
I'll have to bring some of my magazines too, because I got one of these things in the mail. You know, they went, oh, it's like, I don't know, $1.22 a week or something. And all of a sudden, I'm getting Living, Martha Stewart, People, Us.
Oh, well, that would be
horses,
good.
Horses, gardening. I'm thinking, what am I going to do with all these magazines?
There you go.
I'll bring them so that people
nice.
Can. And even
Absolutely.
Just the pictures and things are so pretty in them and the advertisements.
Yeah,
you know, they and then sometimes they come in with those sample colognes in there. You can rip them out and put them on.
Yeah, there you go.
Something else.
Well, we want to, before we close, we just want to make a few comments about world events, because right now in the pro-life community, we are beyond ourselves with excitement over things that are happening in Washington. We're thrilled about the new Supreme Court nominee. And the real possibility that Roe v. Wade could now finally, after all these years of work and prayer, that Roe v. Wade could be overturned. If that would happen, then the issue would go back to the states. And I just read yesterday, I think it is, there's 22 states right now. If Roe v. Wade was overturned tomorrow, there's already 22 states that are, would be willing to end abortion in their states. So this is the time. We've waited through many, many years, many, many presidents, and finally we're in a position where we're going to see some real change. And if this current candidate for Supreme Court is confirmed, there'll likely be another one shortly, because Ruth Ginsburg is 85 years old, and it's likely she'll be retiring soon. So that would open up the possibility of another Supreme Court justice that would be open to reversing and eliminating Roe v. Wade. So we're just thrilled about that. We're also excited about the elections that are coming up this fall. We have great pro-life candidates who, by the way, need your work. They need your help. They need your financial support. The voter registration in Pennsylvania is heavily Democratic. So we need to, that tends, people tend then to vote party line. And we'd like to see a pro-life governor elected. And so we have a lot of exciting things going on. We're going to have a pro-life picnic September the 23rd,
yeah,
I think.
Sunday the 23rd.
Mm-hmm. At Kissinger Church, and that's going to be a lot of fun. If you're interested in attending that, you can contact us at Pro-Life Berks. We'd love to have you come to that and socialize a little with other pro-lifers.
And bring
your children.
We'll,
it's a great
games.
Place. We're going to put the banners up again on the overpass. And
oh, that
is so much fun for kids. And it's very safe. There's a high fence there. And it's fun. It's fun for everybody.
We
every
had 102 cars, yes, or vehicles a minute. Go by,
right, on,
and people honking and,
yeah,
and
we did,
clapping.
We did National Pro-Life
up.
Bridge Day there, and it was so much fun.
It was a lot
and
of fun.
Over 12,000 cars in 2 hours. So we're going to be doing that. We're also going to be inviting we're going to invite all the pro-life candidates, so hopefully we can get them to come. Carolyn knows them better.
I already have one commitment.
Good. Okay.
So far.
So it's going to be a fun day. So mark that on your calendar and let us know. The deadline for registering for that is the 19th, I think.
No, it has to.
What do I have down there? The deadline.
Yes, the 19th.
The 19th.
19th.
But if you could just let us know, that's going to be a
picnic.
Lot of fun. So we're still praying every week at Planned Parenthood. You can come on a Tuesday, 9 o'clock, and pray with us. Or you can come down anytime and pray. But Tuesday mornings is still abortion day. We hand out literature to the girls going in. So with that, we want to see you next month. We're going to have a great show. We're going to have a debate. You're going to love it.
It's going to be
that,
August the 20th.
August the 20th. Good night.
Night. Thank
Good
you.
Night. Thanks.
Thank you.
Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.